Today, I shall take up Unit 2 of Pharmaceutical Inorganic Chemistry, which is Acid, Bases and Buffers. In this unit, we shall study acid and bases concepts, buffer equation, buffer capacity, buffers used in pharmaceutical systems, buffered isotonic solution, measurement of tonicity, methods of adjusting tonicity, major extra and intracellular electrolyte. Besides, we shall also study functions of major physiological ions, electrolyte used in replacement therapy, compounds like sodium chloride, potassium chloride, calcium gluconate, physiological acid-base balance, oral rehydration salt, dental products, dentifrices, role of fluoride in dental caries, calcium gluconate, sodium fluoride, zinc eugenol cement. These three compounds are we are going to study in dentifrices. So let us start the syllabus topics one by one. The first one is acid, bases and buffers. Acid, this is not a new term for you. You have heard about the acid and bases in your science subject since class 7th. So acids, these are the substances which generally turn blue litmus red. They taste sour, khatte hote hain ye. The pH is less than 7. On the other hand, bases or alkaline substances are the substance which turns red litmus blue. They taste bitter. Acids are sour and tastes are bitter. Bases are bitter in taste, kadwe hote hain. Bases have the pH greater than 7. The examples of acids will include hydrochloric acid, sulfuric acid and acetic acid. Bases include sodium hydroxide, NaOH, potassium hydroxide, KOH. Now, the acid and bases are known since ages and different scientists have given different theories explaining the behavior and their mechanism of action. Under these three different theories, we need to study Arrhenius theory, Bronsted-Lowry concept and Lewis acid and base. We shall study these theory of different scientists one by one. Let us come to the first theory, Arrhenius theory of electrolyte dissociation. Dissociation means dissociating, that is breaking into parts. This theory was given by the Swedish scientist Arrhenius in 1887. He said, whenever an electrolyte is dispersed in any medium or solvent, it dissociates, means it breaks into positive and negative charges. This process is called ionization. And the ions which are formed upon the dissociation, they carry electric current. They are responsible to carry current. This process takes place only when there is a medium or solvent. This doesn't take place in the solids. Depending upon this, Arrhenius told about acids and bases. According to the scientist Arrhenius, acids are the substance that produce proton in the solution, say H ions or protons. These are the ones which are produced by the acids or which are given up by the acids. For example, HCl undergoes dissociation to produce H ion. You can have a look on this equation that HCl dissociates into proton ion. And what is remaining is the chloride, that is a negative ion. Now, the bases are the substance that dissociate to give the hydroxyl ion. For example, NaOH. Have a look on this equation. The NaOH dissociates into Na plus ions and hydroxyl ions. So this is the process which takes place in the base, and the substance which give this hydroxyl OH negative ion is called base as per the acids. So we can conclude here that acid is giving up the proton and bases is giving up the hydroxyl ions. Now acid and bases, when they react with each other, they neutralize and they form water. Let us see how does this happen. HCl undergoes dissociation to give H plus ion and chloride ion. Then NaOH dissociates into Na plus ion and hydroxyl ion. Now when we combine these two equations, we get that acid and base, they react with each other to give the salt, which is sodium chloride in this case, and water molecule. This process is called neutralization. When acid and base react with each other in presence of a solvent, the reaction is called neutralization. Some more example of acids and bases shall include sulfuric acid. This is acid which is given by the formula H2SO4. Hydrobromic acid, which is HBr. Bases include sodium hydroxide, that is NaOH, and potassium hydroxide, which is KOH. Now have a look on this equation. Here ammonia, do you think it has the proton ion to give, or do you think it has hydroxyl ion to give? Does it has O in its formula here? No. But still it is a base. Likewise, we can have a look here, sulfur dioxide. Sulfur dioxide is acidic in nature, means it should give protons. But can we see proton here in its formula? No. Similarly, we can't see any proton coming out of sulfur dioxide. So what does this mean? It means that as per Arrhenius theory, we cannot explain the acidic and basic behavior of these two compounds. That's why came another theory which was called as Bronsted-Lowry concept. Now this pair of scientists, they give another justification or the mechanism of action of acids and bases. As per them, acid is a substance that can donate a proton, and base is a substance that can take up or accept a proton. So let us have a look on this reaction. Here HA is the acid which is going to give up the proton, and this proton will combine with the water giving the hydronium ion. Now when HA has given the proton, it will be left with A negative ion. This negative ion is the conjugate base. I repeat here, when acid gives up a proton, it is left with conjugate base. Similarly, base is a substance which can accept or take up a proton. Now when this base has accepted a proton, its induct form is called conjugate acid. So in this reaction, we can see that this HA acid has formed a conjugate base because it has given up the proton, and it is left with A negative ion, which is conjugate base. Similarly, this base has taken up the proton and it has formed a conjugate acid, which is hydronium ion. As per the Bronsted-Lowry concept, we can explain the acidic nature of various other acids. Let us have a look on the acids and their conjugate bases. The first one is HA, which gives the proton, and A negative. Now what is this A negative? This is a conjugate base. Similarly, hydrochloric acid, that is HCl, again It gives H plus ion, proton, and what is chloride? Conjugate base. Then we have sulfuric acid, H2SO4. Now this H2SO4 gives up what? Proton. And what we are left with? Sulfate anion, which is what? Which is a conjugate base. Then we have acetic acid, CH3COOH. Acetic acid is a weak acid, but still it gives up the proton. And what we are left with is acetate ion. So this is what? This is a conjugate base. Then we have ammonium ion here. Now this ammonium ion also gives up what? Proton. What we are left with is ammonia, which is what? Conjugate base. So why do we call conjugate base? As per the theory, Bronsted-Lowry said, acid is a substance which gives up the proton. Now this HA has given up the proton. This A negative ion is ready to accept the proton. That is why we call it as a conjugate base, because base is a substance which takes a proton. Similarly, we can explain the behavior of bases and their conjugate acids as per the Bronsted-Lowry concept. As per them, again, base is a substance which takes up the proton. For example, B plus has taken the proton and forming an adduct BH plus. Now this BH plus is what? Now this is its conjugate acid. Similarly, hydroxyl ion has taken up the proton and formed water. Now this water is what? This is a conjugate acid. Sulfate ion SO4 negative has taken proton and forms sulfuric acid. This sulfuric acid is what? This is a conjugate acid. Ammonia has taken up again what? Proton. Why it has taken a proton? Because it is a base, and bases are those substances which takes up the proton, and it has formed what? Ammonium ion. Now this ammonium ion is what? It is a conjugate base. Similarly, we have phosphorus ion. Now this has given what? Proton to form phosphoric acid. Phosphoric acid is conjugate acid. So we have a look here that bases, they take up the proton and form what? Conjugate acids. This is example when acid and base both react with each other. Have a look on this equation. In this equation, ammonia, that is NH3, reacts with hydrochloric acid HCl to give ammonium ion, and chloride ion is left. Now let us study which term is what here. See, ammonia is going to take up the proton. So ammonia is what? It is a Bronsted-Lowry base. Now when this base has taken up a proton, it has formed what? Ammonium ion. So this ammonium ion is its conjugate acid. Similarly, in the equation we have hydrochloric acid. Hydrochloric acid is the acid which gives up the proton. So this HCl has given the proton and left with chloride ion, which is its conjugate base. So this is an example of conjugate acid base pair as per the Bronsted-Lowry concept. The next concept which came up was the Lewis concept of acid and bases. As per the Lewis, acid is a substance which is electron pair acceptor. It accepts the pair of electron. And on the contrary, base is a substance which donates or which gives electron pair. So base is electron pair donor. Let us have the look on these reactions here. Acid, this is the acid H proton, which is ready to accept the electron pair given by ammonia. This is the electron pair which is taken up by proton ion. As the earlier concept, proton ion is the one which is giving up the proton, but here it is also taking up the electron pair. So, the Bronsted-Lowry acid is also a Lewis acid, and then it forms the adduct or the addition compound. Similarly, this acid is going to take up the proton from the ammonia, which is a base, and form adduct here, trifluorobromide. Then we have another acid which is going to take up the electron pair and form this adduct. Likewise, another acid which is going to take up this electron pair and form an adduct. So, these are the Lewis acids and bases. Let us have one more reaction to explain it more. In this is a Lewis acid which is going to take up the proton and form the adduct. Now, acid and bases, they basically dissociate to show their action. This we had started. Acid can be strong as well as it can be a weak. As we studied earlier, acid is a substance which gives up proton. It does so when it get dissociate. Wo tootta hai, tabhi proton ion usme se nikalta hai. Now, any acid which is going to dissociate faster or easily or completely is going to behave as a strong acid. Why strong? Kyunki wo bahut jaldi se, bahut asani se apna proton de deta hai. To proton dena uska acidic behavior hai. Right? So, the strong acid, they get dissociated completely. For example, we have HCl here. Now, this HCl breaks into protons and chloride, and this process is very rapid. So, HCl is a strong acid, right? Now, this HCl has given proton, and what is left with the chloride ion? This chloride ion is what? Its conjugate base. Since HCl has given proton so readily, the chloride ion won't take up that proton so easily. It means the conjugate bases of these acids are very weak. Why? Because they have less affinity for the proton. We have one more example here of the strong acid, that is sulfuric acid, H2SO4, which dissociate into two proton ions and sulfate ion. Similarly, the bases are also categorized as strong or weak. Let us study first a weak acid. As we did, the acid which dissociates completely is a strong, and the acid which dissociates partially means adhura, incomplete. Jo acid pura dissociate nahi hota hai, आसानी से डिसोसिएट नहीं होता है और प्रोटॉन आयंस उतनी ही आसानी से नहीं देता, दैट इज योर वीक एसिड. फॉर एग्जाम्पल, वी हैव एसिटिक एसिड हियर. नाउ दिस एसिटिक एसिड डिसोसिएट पार्शियली, पूरा डिसोसिएट नहीं होता है. इट गिव्स व्हाट? इट गिव्स एसिटेट आयंस एंड प्रोटॉन्स. नाउ सिंस दिस एसिड आर वीक, ठीक है, तो कॉरस्पॉन्डिंगली उनके जो कॉन्जुगेट बेस होंगे वो स्ट्रांग होंगे. राइट? से कॉन्जुगेट बेसिस ऑफ दीज एसिड्स आर स्ट्रांग. व्हाई? बिकॉज दे हैव ग्रेटर एफिनिटी फॉर द प्रोटॉन. नाउ द एसिडिक एंड बेसिक बिहेवियर और द एसिडिक नेचर ऑल्सो डिपेंड ऑन द डिग्री ऑफ आयनाइजेशन. किस एक्सटेंट, किस डिग्री तक एक एसिड जो है वो आयनाइज हो रहा है. लेट अस हैव इन द इन दिस इक्वेशन हियर. से HA प्लस वाटर रिएक्ट्स टू गिव हाइड्रोनियम आयन एंड A नेगेटिव एनायन. अकॉर्डिंग टू लॉ ऑफ मास इक्वेशन, इफ आई हैव टू राइट द इक्विलिब्रियम कांस्टेंट, आई विल राइट द इक्वेशन K equivalent is equal to hydronium ion into anion, which are the products, upon reactant, which is HA plus and H2O. So we have this equation here where we have done just the half cross multiply. Now this Ka is what? This is the ionization constant, and this Ka varies or changes with the strength. If Ka is greater than 1, it means the acid is stronger, and if Ka is less than 1, it means acid is weak. The Ka or the ionization constant varies directly with the strength of the acid. Besides this, the strength of the ionization of acid and bases also depend on the solvent present. For example, we did HCl is a stronger acid when the solvent is water. It ionizes good. Its ionization is what? Good. But when the same HCl is present in the presence of ammonia, its ionization is bad. Then we have acetic acid, which is a weak acid. If the solvent is water, its ionization is bad. But the same acetic acid is going to behave like as a good acid when the solvent is ammonia. Further examples we can note for the strong acids: HCl, hydrochloric acid; nitric acid; sulfuric acid. Weak acids include acetic acid, formic acid, and carbonic acid. Strong bases include sodium hydroxide, NaOH, and potassium hydroxide. Weak bases include calcium hydroxide and ammonium hydroxide. So this was regarding acid and bases. Now let us come to the buffer. This term you might have heard earlier also. Buffers are the substances which resist any kind of change in the pH. These are compounds or mixtures of compound in solution. They neutralize small amount of added acid or base and thus maintain the pH of the solution. Suppose if you have a solution which has pH of 3.2, right? In that case, if we add more acid to it or more base to it, it is but obviously that the pH is going to change. But if the buffer is going to be present there, it is going to resist the change in the pH. Buffers are generally made by weak acid and its conjugate base, and weak base and its conjugate acid. Buffer action means the resistance to change in the pH, and the buffer capacity is number of millimoles of acid or base which is to be added to liter of buffer solution to change the pH by 1 unit. This is a formula where B is millimoles upon delta pH, that is change in the pH. Now few characteristics of the buffer: they have definite pH value, their pH do not change on dilution, their pH do not change upon standing for the longer periods or very slightly altered. Example include weak acid and its base. For example, acetic acid and its salt, sodium acetate. Likewise, a solution of ammonia and ammonium chloride is another buffer example. Buffers can be divided into two categories: acidic buffers and alkaline or basic buffers. Acidic buffers are used to maintain obviously acidic environment, and they have the acidic pH. They are generally prepared by mixing a weak acid along with its salt. Then aqueous solution of an equal concentration of acetic acid, that is CH3COOH, plus its salt, that is CH3COONa. This is an example of the buffer which has a pH of 4.74. Acidic buffers have pH less than 7. Now let us study alkaline or the basic buffers. These are used to maintain the basic conditions, They have basic pH, that is pH greater than 7. An example include equal concentration of ammonium hydroxide and ammonium chloride, which has pH of 9.25. Now, let us study few buffers which are used in pharmaceutical formulation or pharmaceutical systems. For example, the buffer system of hydrochloric and KCl, this is a buffer system, and the pH range in which it is active is 1.2 to 2.2. As I told, buffer has a pH range in which they can resist the change in the pH. It's not possible कि अगर आपके सॉल्यूशन में बफर है तो आप कितना भी एसिड उसमें डालते जाएंगे चेंज नहीं आएगा. नो, इट इज़ नॉट सो. अब बफर हैज़ इट्स ओन कैपेसिटी, अपनी ही क्षमता या कैपेसिटी तक ही वो पीएच को झेल सकता है. तो हमें बफर जो है पीएच रेंज के अकॉर्डिंग बनाने होते हैं, राइट? सो अनदर एग्जाम्पल इज HCl एंड पोटेशियम हाइड्रोजन फ्थेलेट, विच हैज़ अ बफर पीएच रेंज ऑफ 2.2 to 4. Then we have sodium hydroxide and potassium hydrogen phthalate, which has a pH range of 4.2 to 5.8. Another example is the buffer of boric acid and sodium carbonate monohydrate with a pH buffer range of 5 to 9. Then we have potassium dihydrogen phosphate and sodium hydroxide with pH buffer range of 5.8 to 8. Another example includes boric acid, sodium hydroxide and potassium chloride with a pH buffer range of 8 to 10. I hope I am clear here that the buffers are the solutions which change and resist the change in the pH. They have their buffer capacity and they are active till a buffer range which is given by their specified. So, this is the topic. So, students, I hope I have made the concepts clear in your mind. Acid, bases and buffers. Acid is a substance which gives up the proton. Base is a substance which takes up the proton. Buffers are the substances which resist any kind of change in their pH. They work till their capacity. It's not that you keep on adding acid and base and buffer is going to be effective. They work in a defined buffer range. So these are the buffers. Our body has different buffers in our system, the different biological buffers we shall study in the next class. Besides, there are different pharmaceutical buffers which are used to maintain the stability and the other aspects. Thank you.